Greetings, Guardians. My name is Byfear. So, let's talk a little more about the communications from the darkness. I took a bit of a break from this series for a week, partly because I needed to take a little time off, and partly because I thought that these two entries really should be read together. Chronologically speaking, of course, one flows after the other, but also, they're reading into each other very directly. For those of you who are a little out of the loop, I'll indulge you in the quickest little recap here. When we completed the Garden of Salvation raid, we were left with a final mysterious note. Before us lay a statue similar to the one that we'd found inside the pyramid ship on Luna, and upon our return it was clear that we were meant to find it, as a series of messages began to be transmitted from the artifact that we had recovered from the pyramid. It was clear that these messages were communications not from some foe like the Hive, but from the darkness itself. And so, even as it clearly may be trying to sway us to its side, we will be listening to the messages that we received from the darkness. Let's break down these communications and let's dissect their meaning. And of course, we must always remember that there may be lies mixed in with this truth. Previously, we spoke about how the Gardener and the Winnower, the Light and the Dark, were supposedly two primordial forces that existed in the universe in a time before time. They played a game of creation upon a field of possibilities, which is described by the darkness through the analogy of a great game of flowers, with rules that always led to the same outcome. In time, as interesting developments were snuffed out repeatedly, the gardener, which is shorthand for the light in this analogy, became angered. And so we're led onto the next entry of this particular set of communications, an entry known as the Final Shape, which reads as follows. "It always ends the same," the gardener complained. "This one stupid pattern." "Aren't they beautiful?" I asked, as the flowers opened and closed in patterns beyond the scope of entire universes to encode, all devouring and perhaps everlasting. Not even we could know whether a pattern in the flowers would cycle forever or someday halt. "They're as dull as carbon monoxide poisoning," the gardener groused, although carbon monoxide did not yet exist, and neither did anything that could be poisoned. The gardener kneeled to flick a patch of sod with their trowel. It struck an open flower, causing it to shut. Although I was the closer of flowers, and that was my sole purpose, I felt no fear or jealousy. We had our assigned dominions, and always would. "They're majestic," I said. "They have no purpose except to subsume all other purposes. There is nothing at the center of them except the will to go on existing, to alter the game to suit their existence. They spare not one sliver of their totality for any other work. They are the end." The pattern corrected the errant flower effortlessly. The great flow went on unchanged. The gardener got up and brushed their knees. "Every game we play, this one pattern consumes all the others, wipes out every interesting development. A stupid, boring exploit that cuts off entire possibility spaces from ever arising. There's so much that we'll never get to see because of this pest." They chewed at their cracked lip, which existed only because this is an allegory. "I'm going to do something about it," they said. "We need a new rule." Needless to say, when analyzing anything from this law book, there are bound to be shocking implications. We, of course, have dealt with a law book here that has previously stated that it contains within its pages the very origin point of the universe, and the origin story of the light and the darkness as the gardener and the winnower. So to see shocking revelations on the actions of the light, or the gardener at very least, is not too surprising. However, the first thing to be implicated here is simply that this is a tale told by darkness, and so I would remind you that any details you read here may be variations on the truth, untrue entirely, or simply a truth that misses context. So, be aware of this. We are being told but a perspective. However, the first thing that is implied by the darkness here would be, surprisingly, that there is a bit of a reprimand that we could make of the light. The passage linked here implies that the light was a cosmic force, unsettled with the status quo of the universe, and that it was the instigator of any conflict between the two sides. It also implies that the light, in its fury, temporarily destroyed a flower. Remember that flowers in the flower game are all part of an analogy, and so they could realistically represent anything from the dawn of creation, even possibly entire universes. And according to all of this, the light kicked mud onto one of those flowers, making it close. The flower was then reopened. Let's imagine that it is a universe for a second there. The light's disgruntled reply to the darkness, stating that the entirety of the system of rules was stupid and repetitive and a pest. That results in the light flicking mud onto a flower, or, if we're to take the allegory to a possible conclusion, destroying a universe for it to then be remade. That's all very speculative, but you can understand the scale of the conflict of closing a flower there. You can start to understand what it might be. It's not necessarily that, but you can start to understand and grasp it. Again, I think it's worth highlighting that the darkness does not necessarily tell truth, but instead, perhaps is telling a perspective. There is, of course, also the note that it states that the light and the gardener were the instigators of almost all conflict within the universe at this point, by bringing this unnatural rule into the garden, and by adding it to the game. And what is the result of this? Chaos, in a certain sense. Fear, panic, and fury from the perspective of the darkness. And all of this is expressed in the next passage, known as the First Knife. It reads as follows. I looked up in shock. I said, "What? What do you mean?" "A special new rule. Something to..." The gardener threw up their hands in exasperation. "I don't know. To reward those who make space for new complexity. A power that helps those who make strength from heterodoxy, and who steer the game away from gridlock. Something to ensure there's always someone building something new. It'll have to be separate from the rest of the rules, running in parallel, so it can't be compromised. And we'll have to be very careful so it doesn't disrupt the whole game." "All you will do," I said with rising panic, fury, "is delay the dominant pattern that will overrun the others. It is inevitable. One final shape." "No, it'll be different. Everything will be different. Every way you look."
"Everything will be the same. Your new rule will only make great false cysts of horror full of things that should not exist, that cannot withstand existence, that will suffer and scream as their rich blisters fill with effluent and rot around them. And when they pop, they will blight the whole garden. Whatever exists because it must exist, and because it permits no other way of existence, has the absolute claim to existence. That is the only law."
"No," the gardener said. "I am the growth and preservation of complexity. I will make myself into a law in the game."
And thus, we too became parts of the game, and the laws of the game became nomic and open to change by our influence. And I had only one purpose and one principle in the game, and I could do nothing but continue to enact that purpose, because it was all I was and would ever be. I looked at the gardener. I looked at my hands. I discovered the First Knife. This brings us to a point before time's beginning where we might potentially see the origin of the conflict between the light and the darkness, and that's an incredible discovery if it's all true. Keep in mind as well, again, substance and fact is not necessarily guaranteed with the writings of the Unveiling Lore book, but what is fascinating is simply this. As the game goes on, existence became such that the gardener decided that it had to become one of the rules of the game,
and thus the winnower, the darkness, became part of the game as well. It's at this point that we can suddenly see that the darkness actually has knives in its hands, and so perhaps this is the very origin of conflict itself. Although whether death and the natural reaping of the garden at the end of each night could be seen as death and the origin of conflict is something to be discussed and debated later. Having said that, I feel like it's clear that this is the first time that the gardener and the winnower had clashed, even though their ideals ran in opposition to each other for some time. These messages from the darkness will of course continue, and as we learn more about what happened in that garden before time, I'm sure there will be many questions to be asked and answered. I will continue this series over the coming weeks, and I actually want to go into a little more analysis about the light when I get a chance as I get back into the series. There's a whole lot of stuff about the gardener in particular that we get told, and I think it's worth covering. When we learn more about the darkness, I will of course cover that as well. I do, however, believe that there is some merit in covering the gardener as a specific topic in one of these videos, and the reason why is because the gardener is not simply mentioned as the gardener in the Unveiling Lore book alone. The Mark 44 Standicides, Lumina, even Rasputin's most early communication regarding the Collapse, all reference the gardener. They all reference the light, or in some cases, the Traveler. And with that, there's an intriguing similarity that we might be able to draw. However, this is just one entry in a long, winding series. So, if you did enjoy it, please go ahead and hit subscribe, hit the like button, and of course, if you want to stay up to date truly, hit the bell next to subscribe to turn on those email notifications. In addition, you can leave your own thoughts and commentary down below in the description. Do you believe that this was the origin point for all conflict? Do you believe that this was the first disagreement? Do you believe this to be the origin point of the first war? One between light and darkness, simplicity and complexity, the one final shape, and what would eventually be known as the bomb logic. Tell me what you think in the comments section down below. But of course, know that your viewership is quite enough for me. And in the meantime, my name has been My Name is Bife. Purodasya Arastra. I'll see you, Starside.